of, can I lose my salvation? Once you get saved, the idea is, actually the question was, is once saved always saved true? And there's always a question that people have about that, because that's a standard way or kind of a denominational way of talking about eternal security, once saved always saved. And is it really true that once you're saved and you're in the family of God that you can never get out of it? Here's an email that came in this morning. And it comes from a man out in Colorado. I'm giving thanks this morning for your ministry. It was 40 years ago on this date that you looked into a crowd of Rocky Mountain Grace Camp and said, some of you are wondering tonight if you have done everything just right to be saved. Well, you can stop wondering because you haven't. Christ did it all right for you. Lightning struck in my heart that night, and I trusted him on the rickety wooden pew of Oak Ridge, of Quaker Ridge. Thank you. I'll forever be grateful. That's how you get saved. You just trust Christ. Quit trusting yourself, trust him. Quit trusting what you think you can do, what you think you can't do, and let what he did. It's not do, do, do. It's done, done, done. And when you trust what he's done, that's the issue. I had another email this week from a lady who listens to our radio program. And she said, I've been confused about my salvation for ages. My mom's church tells me one thing, my friends at work something else, quite different. I've listened to radio and TV preachers looking for answers, but only get more confused. Last night I prayed and asked the Lord to please give me answers from the Bible. Today, while eating lunch, I was again listening to the radio, searching for answers, and you were there speaking about salvation by God's grace, that there are actually two programs in the Bible, one for Israel, one for us, one where they had to do things to please God, and one where God did everything for us. You said it was the difference between do, 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 and done, done, done. As you explained the scriptures, for the first time, it all became clear. Thank you. Now I know for sure that I'm saved because I've trusted Jesus Christ alone as my Savior. Please tell the people that put you on the radio a big thanks from someone who has found peace with God at last. I'll look forward to meeting you one day. That's the way you get saved. You don't get saved based on what you do. You get saved based on what Christ did. The only thing you can do is trust him. And once you've trusted him, and you've trusted him from that perspective, then the question comes along, and religion does, and your flesh will do it. Will it last? Is it forever? If you look with me at Colossians chapter number 2, Colossians chapter 2 in one hand and 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, two books right by each other. Colossians 2 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse number 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. See the issue of much assurance? God desires us to have much assurance about our salvation, about having trusted Christ and our ability to depend upon him and the all-sufficiency of him to be our Savior. Colossians chapter 2, verse 2. That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, unto all the riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledging of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. See that issue of the full assurance of understanding? Full assurance of your salvation comes from understanding some things about it. It's not an emotional experience, it's an understanding experience. It's an embracing of some truth about the person who is the truth. So when we trust the Lord Jesus Christ, and we trust our understanding of the gospel causes us to rely upon him, then you have much assurance in your heart. And the Spirit of God strengthens you. You're strengthened by His Spirit in your inner man. So, yes, you can have assurance. You can know for sure. You love the first verse over in 1 John 5. These things have I written unto you that you may know that you have everlasting life. In other words, it's a know-so kind of a thing. It isn't maybe, possibly, I hope. It's I absolutely know these things based on what God's Word says. So then why would someone question whether or not they were genuinely saved and the salvation was forever? Well, I'll suggest to you a number of reasons, but the first one boils right down to what the lady said in the email. The confusion comes because one church says one thing and one church says another. You have one group of people over here, the Calvinists, and they say, well, you're saved eternally because God, before the foundation of the world, chose you to be saved. And then you have the folks over here on the other side of that argument, the Arminians, and say, no, you're not saved eternally. You're only saved if you believe. And you're only saved as long as you believe. And so you have the Calvinism and Arminianism are really two sides of the same theological coin. They're both Joseph Arminius and John Calvin were Dutch theologians, and they argued out of the same paradigm. Neither one were dispensationalists. Neither one knew anything about rightly dividing the word of truth and understanding the Bible dispensationally. Had they wouldn't have embraced either of their positions. So people ask me, they say, Brother Rick, are you a Calvinist or an Arminian? I say, no, I'm neither nor. I'm neither a Calvinist nor an Arminian. They don't believe that's possible. So then what are you? I'm a Bible-believing dispensationalist and a grace believer because of that. So there's all the theology out there, but the reason that people get into the confusion that they do about one church saying this, another church saying the other, every church has its theology, and they want to say they get it out of the Bible. Now, the difficulty is that the fundamental reason for the lack of confidence and assurance in salvation is a failure to rightly divide God's Word. Where you don't take the Word of God and you don't rightly divide it, you don't make the application where it belongs, and you begin to mix in different programs in the Bible, and when you don't handle it properly and separate the programs, it's the difference that makes the difference. I'll give you an illustration. Come with me back to Matthew chapter 24. Here's one of the verses that comes up quite often. Matthew 24. When I was, a number of years ago, my uncle, who was a Baptist preacher, he was my wife's pastor when she was young, he went to be with the Lord. And we went to the funeral. It's in Mobile. And it was fascinating because my dad's family were Baptist and part were either Methodist or Nazarene, which is Wesleyan. So part were Calvinist and part were Arminian. Part believe once saved, always saved. Part believe that's a damnable doctrine. And so when we walked around the funeral, you know, you go to the funeral home, there's all the people and you're milling around. And we walked around and I'm through the group over here and they'd say, Jim was a great preacher. He believed in once saved, always saved. And then we'd go around to the other side and they said, Jim was a great preacher, except he believed in once saved, always saved. And now the families all broke up about it. And my dad, he used to say, I'm more secure than any Baptist ever thought he was. Because he believed, as long as he believed, he was saved. He was a believer. He said, when you're a believer, you're secure. But if you quit believing, well, don't mess around with it. And I asked him, I said, well, what about this verse, Dad? 2 Timothy 2, verse 13. If we believe not, yet he abides faithful, he cannot deny himself. And he said, let me look at that again. And that verse changed his mind about that. But the problem that you have with it, and I was walking around that room, I can remember my aunt, who was of the no once saved, always saved doctrine. She said to me, she says, you know, Jim was a great preacher. We loved him. But he taught that once saved, always saved. And listen, Ricky, don't you forget. And she quoted Matthew 24, verse 13. He that endureth to the end shall be saved. And I can still hear my Aunt Mabel saying that. Now that's what the verse says. But he that endureth to the end shall be saved. So in that verse and in her mind, eternal life was conditioned on enduring to the end. And if I'd have said, Dame Mabel, what end are you talking about? She'd have said, well, to the end of your life. And she was happy that Uncle Jim had endured to the end of his life in the faith, and she was confident he was in heaven because of that. But the problem with that, that isn't what that verse is about. And when you take a verse out of its context and you try to apply it to just any context, you make a pretext out of it. A verse without a context is a con, and that's what people do with it. Now look at Matthew 24, and just think about it for a minute. The context in Matthew 24 is not salvation from the penalty of sin. But what salvation is it? Look down at verse 15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand, let them flee which be in Jerusalem, let them which be in Jerusalem flee to the mountains. When does the abomination spoken of by Daniel, abomination does it stand in the holy place? That's in the middle of the seventh week of Daniel. The context in Matthew 24 is the prophetic program, Israel's kingdom program, talking about being saved from the deception and the Antichrist and the deception associated with him. Look down at verse number. You see verse 16, let them which be in Jerusalem flee. Why? You got to flee from the Antichrist, flee from the destruction that he's going to cause. Verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation, which was not since the beginning of the world to this time. No, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there shall, watch, no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be saved. See, the salvation being talking here about here is not salvation from the penalty of sin. It's not talking about eternal. It's talking about a physical salvation to a group of people in the tribulation period who are facing the assault of the Antichrist and the persecution that's going to come because of that. And he says, when you see that, flee, run, get out, because there's destruction coming. And if you want to be saved from that destruction, you want your life extended, you get away. So the context in the passage has nothing to do, one, with a member of the body of Christ. See verse 14, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. No, we don't preach the gospel of the kingdom. This is part of Israel's kingdom program. So when you rightly divide the word of truth and you understand where to put things on the timeline of Scripture, you understand immediately this verse doesn't have anything to do with us today. It has to do with the deliverance of the elect remnant of Israel at the end of the day of the Lord in the great tribulation, and it's talking about the opportunity to be delivered and the salvation that Christ is going to give to that remnant at His second advent. It has nothing to do with salvation into the church, the body of Christ. You and I have an eternal life today because we've trusted Christ. Now that same kind of a verse, come with me in Hebrews chapter 3. If you ask people, show me verses that tell you can lose your salvation. That's one of them. By the way, before you leave Matthew, go back to Matthew chapter, where you're in Matthew 24. Look over at chapter 25. Matthew 25. You know the parable of the 10 virgins. There's all kind of books and tracts about the midnight call and so forth that comes out of this passage. Verse number 6, Matthew 25, 6. And at midnight there shall be a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, no, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgin, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. And he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour, what day or no hour, where the Son of Man cometh. And so there's a whole doctrine people teach that you need to be watching, you need to be diligent, you need to be on your toes, you need to be continuing, because you don't know when the door will be shut. And when it's shut, you can't get in. And if you're not ready, if you're not prepared, if you're not enduring, then you lose your salvation. Well, that's, did you notice verse 1? Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto, this is the kingdom, this again is Israel's kingdom program. And if you know enough about your Bible to know that's not us today, that's Israel's program, it's not the body of Christ, it's Israel's kingdom program, you might not understand what the parable's about, but you certainly understand it's not about you. The problem with taking passages out of their dispensational context is that they confuse. You try to apply verses that don't have anything to do with you. Look back at chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. And Matthew is full of these passages. Matthew chapter 7. Verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many shall say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto you, unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. That's exactly what he said to the five unfaithful virgins that ran out of oil over there. Look at chapter 6, Matthew 6. The Our Father prayer, verse number 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is the official prayer of the Roman Catholic Churches, the official prayer of Christendom. When I was in high school, junior high school rather, back in the dark ages, my wife and I went to the same junior high school. Every morning, they had a devotion, came over the PA system, and they played a song that sang this prayer: "Our Father which art in." Aren't you glad I don't sing? You've heard that, and that was the morning devotion. This was the official prayer. Verse number 14. For if you, now this is Jesus afterwards, for if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Would that verse give you any assurance of your salvation? No. Why? Because you know there are some dudes you just aren't going to forgive. They've done things to you that you just can't get over. And you don't forgive. I've had people cry and weep. I sat at a table with a lady, and she wept bitter tears over her inability to forgive some people who had done things to her children. And she cried, and she says, "I can't forgive them, and that means God can't forgive me." Now, that's taking the scripture and using it in an evil way. Misunderstanding it. So you see, come with Hebrews chapter 3, if you don't put the verses where they belong, there are verses in the Bible that can tell you you can lose your salvation. So it isn't that people just don't believe the Bible. Sometimes it's because they don't rightly divide the Bible. Hebrews chapter 3. There are all these warning passages in the book of Hebrews. Chapter 2, he says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Don't hold on to them. Don't continue in them. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression or disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which was first began to be spoken by the Lord? If under the Mosaic law that God gave Moses the law by angels, and if those words that he gave to Moses were strictly enforced, how much more shall the words that Christ gave us? And if they let those words slip and they got judgment, how much more danger would we be in if we let the words of Christ slip? And Hebrews starts out with that kind of warning. Chapter 3, verse number Well, I'll start in verse number 4. For every house is builded by some man, but he that buildeth all things is God. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony to those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ as a son over his own house. Whose house are we if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end? So what do you have to do in that passage to be his house? God's house. Christ's house. You have to hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. He that endureth to the end shall be saved. Now what was the end in Matthew? It was the end of the tribulation, end of the 70th week. You know what the end is going to be here? The same thing. You go back to the book of Daniel and see the end, the end, the end, the end, the end. It's over and over. It's a reference to the end of that 70th week. Look down to verse number 14. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. Can you see why? If you thought those verses were about you, I said this morning, if you want to take the book of Hebrews and apply it to yourself, you do it at your own risk of spiritual confusion. Because these verses give you no ability to have any assurance that your salvation is eternal. It's conditioned on holding fast, enduring to the end. Now, when you understand it's written to the Hebrews, and it's written about a particular time period in God's dealings with the nation, is it? You can understand, oh, it's not about... I had someone tell me just recently, they were all mad, say, you just say everything belongs to Israel. I said, no, I don't say anything belongs to Israel except what belongs to them. That's not that hard. You know, how do you know what belongs to them? Well, who's the book written to? That's not that hard. If you go back to chapter 2, verse number 3, how shall we escape so if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord? That's Matthew 24. That's Matthew 6. That's Matthew 7. And was confirmed unto us by them which heard him, God also bearing them witness with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts. That's the apostles and the little flock in the book of Acts. For unto the angels which he hath not, for unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak. What's the writer of the book of Hebrews think he's talking about? He thinks he's talking about what Christ taught in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, what the apostles taught in early Acts, and what's going to come in the ages to come. He didn't think he's talking about the body of Christ. He didn't think about he's talking about the but now time period and dispensation of grace. So the things when you read about it, you say, well, what end is he talking about? He's talking about the coming of the kingdom. Come over with me to chapter 6. Hebrews is a hotbed for this stuff. Hebrews chapter 6, verse number 4. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and been made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted of the good word of God and the powers of the world to become. Now think about that. Have you been made a partaker of the Holy Ghost? Have you been made a partaker of Christ? Hebrews chapter 3 is talking about. Yeah. You've been baptized by the Spirit of God into Jesus Christ. You are in Christ. You're more than a partaker. You're identified as one with him. Well, here's some people that have been put into a relationship with him. And he says it's impossible, verse 6, if they fall away, to renew them again under repentance, seeing they're crucified to themselves, the Son of God afresh, and put him to open shame. Now look at that verse. That verse proves too much. Because people that say you can lose your salvation, they say, well, but you can get saved again. And again, and again, and again. That's one of the definitions that they have of born again. One of the reasons people don't like that expression is because the idea is they say, well, that means you can be born again and again and again and again. See what that verse says? That verse says, if you're partakers of Christ, of the Holy Spirit, and you've tasted the good word of God, and the powers of the world to come, and you've tasted the heavenly gift, you've been enlightened, if you fall away, it's impossible for you to be renewed again. Here's somebody who's come to repentance, they've fallen away, and they can't get saved again. That's proven too much. By the way, when I said they don't like the expression, that's why you hear people say that expression ought to be translated born from above. The New Bible said change that. They don't like the again concept because it says repetitive. This passage says not repetitive. It's a one-time deal. He said, well, wow. Here's somebody that if they fall away, they can't come back. That's lost forever. Come back with me, if you will, to the book of Ezekiel. Not just in the New Testament. People use passages like this. This is a real favorite one. Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel 18, verse 21. But if the wicked will turn from all his sin that he hath committed and keep all my statutes and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. All his transgressions that he hath committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he hath done, he shall live. Now, let me be clear that you understand what's going on here. Ezekiel, like we read those passages in Jeremiah this morning, about Jeremiah talking about destruction is coming. You've not obeyed the law. You've not kept the commandments. And therefore, God's going to send destruction, going to wipe Jerusalem out, make it like Shiloh, destroy it. He's going to take the nation and send them off into captivity. Ezekiel's talking about the same thing here. And when he's talking about dying living, he's not talking about eternal life. He's talking about the nation being destroyed out of the land. So really the issue here is physical life and physical death. Israel is facing that fifth course of judgment. And Ezekiel is saying what Jeremiah said, if you will amend your ways, God said, I'll give you what I promised you. If you don't, then the judgment's coming. Now, under the law, they couldn't. They didn't because they couldn't. But that's the same offer that's being made here. When it says back in verse 4, the verse that is often quoted, Behold, all souls are mine, and the souls of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine, and the soul that sinneth, it shall die. Sometimes people do read that, and they mistake this as eternal death. But in the Old Testament, you have to remember, you go back to the book of Leviticus, for example, and he says, the soul that toucheth any dead body, the soul that toucheth this, how does a soul touch a dead body? How does a soul touch a sacrifice? That's a physical thing. In the Old Testament, a person's soul is identified with them as their body, because spiritually, it's stuck to your body. And when your body does something, your soul does it with it. You know, we look at that new covenant this morning. They're not regenerated. They don't have a spiritual circumcision that cuts their soul identity away from their flesh. And what he's talking about here is their physical death that affects, of course, all of them. And if you go back to verse 20, and by the way, verse 22, when it says, in his righteousness that he hath done, he shall live. He's not talking about his righteous actions are going to get him eternal life. Because you're righteous. You don't have any actions that are going to get you eternal life. But they could get them out from under the judgment of the captivity that's coming. Verse 23, have I any pleasure at all that the wicked shall die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and live? And again, that's physical life and death. For when the righteous turneth away from his righteousness and commit iniquity and doth according to all the abominations that the wicked man doeth, shall he live? All his righteousness that he hath done shall not be mentioned. In his trespass that he hath trespassed, and in his sin hath he that he hath sinned, in them shall he die. Now, think about that. Here's someone who's righteous. If you take that passage, apply it to yourself, and say, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. But if I go out and sin, what happens? All his righteousness that he hath done shall not be mentioned, but in your sin you'll die. And that's a verse that's in my youth was used as a text to tell you, rookie, you better behave. Because if you don't, no matter how good you've been, you screw up and you're dead meat. And you're going to die and go to hell. I was convinced by verses like this particular one, in this one in particular, that what it meant to believe was to work. Because if I believed, I walked the straight and narrow. And as long as I was walking the straight and narrow, now the problem there is that whose straight and narrow you're walking. You know, well, here it's the Lord's, but where I was, it was the denomination. And you say, well, I wind up losing. Look at the next verse. Yet ye say, the way of the Lord is not equal. Hear now, O body of Christ. Is not my way. Is that what it said? Hear now, O house of Israel. Once again, don't take something that belongs to somebody else and apply it to yourself. Come with me to John chapter 15. This is one of my kind of pet peeve ones. If you get around people that in what's called the deeper life Christian movement, where they're talking about, you know, having the deeper experiences in your Christian life, they talk about a lot about abiding in Christ. And you need to abide in Him. And if you're around some of the brethren people and so forth, they talk about abiding in Christ a great deal. The problem is about with the idea of abiding in Christ, what if you quit abiding in Him? In other words, you just made your salvation conditional. Well, that passage, it comes out of John chapter number 15. I am the vine, I am the true vine. Jesus is talking, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he pruneth it, that it may bring forth much fruit. Now ye are clean through the word that I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Now that's a great passage, and it's a great truth. How are you going to bear fruit in that program? You're going to abide in his wisdom, in his life. Keep yourself in him. But look at verse 6. If any man abide not in me, he's in me, I'm in him, but he doesn't abide in me. He doesn't continue. He is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they're burned. Whoa. That don't sound like such a good end. So here's a passage talking about abiding in him. People say, what you need to do, you need to bear fruit, abide in him. And they'll pay attention to the context or what it means in Israel's program, and they apply it to you. And then you decide, I'll read the next verse, because if five verses were good, then, you know, one more wouldn't hurt. And you find out, if I don't abide in him, I don't just have a failure in a Christian life, I wind up cast into the fire. And so what? Wonder what that is. It don't sound good, does it? It's judgment. So, you can, I'm trying to say to you, you can understand why people would have questions. This lady says, my mom's church says one thing, my friend's church says something entirely different. Yeah, and they're quoting verses. And the way you straighten that out is by understanding how to write and divide God's word. So I'm going to suggest to you that the very first reason that people lose, a fundamental reason, maybe not the first one, but a fundamental reason that people question or are convinced to question their eternal security is a failure to rightly divide God's word. More fundamental than that, frankly, is a failure to learn the specific doctrines in Scripture that are designed to give you and produce in you much assurance. There are things that God wants you to understand about your salvation that when you do understand them, then they produce the much assurance. The assurance doesn't come just because you get saved. It comes out of the full assurance of understanding. Think about it like this. Just think about the terms, lost and saved. If I'm lost, and then I get saved, and then I get lost again, what did I really get saved from? I didn't get saved from hell because I go to hell. I didn't get saved from sin because I wound up back in sin. So what did I really get saved from? Nothing. You really didn't get saved. You just had the prospect of being saved. That's why Catholic-leaning type religions tell you it's a sin of presumption to say you are saved. Catholic priests, I went with Jay Perez one time when we were in Neva, and Jay wanted to go and call on his priest. Jay, he'd gotten saved. He'd been raised Roman Catholic for 50 years. And after he got saved, you guys remember Jay. Some of you will. No. My wife remembers Jay. David remembers Jay. You got to be old. You know, did you know you're that old, David? But Jay worked at Sears downtown in the Loop. He was the manager of their appliance department, and when that store closed up, he lost his job, and he didn't know what to do with himself, and he for several months he just kept going back downtown. And he had been going downtown, and that right down the street from it was the mission, Pacific Garden Mission. And he wound up down there one day, heard the gospel, and got saved at the mission. And he started going down there on a regular basis, and he got in with Brother Johnston and so forth down there, and Brother Arnett, and started working around down there, and wound up, before he died, he was the head of the men's department, worked down there, and went through Grace School of the Bible and so forth. Well, Jay, he said to him one day, he said, you know, Brother Rick, I want to go call on my priest where I used to go, the parish over here. So we went over to the rectory, and Jay said, I want to talk to Father, I don't remember his name. And they went and got him. We went and sat down. Hi, Jay, how you doing? Blah, blah, blah. This is Richard, my friend. And I have a question to ask you. He said, okay. He said, if you were to die today, do you know for sure where you'd spend eternity? And that old priest looked at him, and he kind of frowned, and he said, Jay, that would be the sin of presumption for me to know that. Whoa. And then we quite kind of didn't know exactly what to say back to the old boy, except the natural question is, if you could know, would you like to know? It would be the sin of presumption. I would not dare know. Well, that's what religion does. And if you don't understand what being lost means, and you think you can be saved and then lost again, being saved doesn't mean anything. So if you understand what being saved means, then you could understand how you can't be lost if you really are saved. Now, we had a guy come to a conference in Tennessee, in Florida one time, look at Titus chapter 3, and he said to us, you can't say that you're saved. He said, you shouldn't use that terminology. And we thought that was kind of, he was a singer, he was singing for us. And he said, you should never say you're saved. You guys talk about getting saved. He said, you can't say you're saved. And so one of the brothers asked him, he said, Titus chapter 3, verse 5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Well, Paul thought he could say, he saved me, saved us. So maybe it is a term you ought to use. But if you could lose your salvation, you didn't really get saved from anything to start with. Now, how are you saved? Not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed upon us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Being justified by his grace. Now, you know Ephesians 2, verse 8. By grace are you saved through faith. That not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. When you understand the complete exclusion of works by grace, not of works. Look at Romans chapter 11. Here's an unequivocal verse. Romans 11. When you understand this truth about what grace is, then you're going to have a basis to understand your security. Because your salvation doesn't depend on what you do. It depends on what Christ did. And salvation from the penalty of sin, from death, hell, the lake of fire, is established on the basis of what Jesus Christ did. And it's yours the moment that you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. And grace verifies that. That the debt's paid, the penalty is fully paid, without your works of any kind. And if your works didn't pay the debt, then your works aren't going to unpay the debt. Romans chapter 11, verse 6. If by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. You see how exclusive grace is? Grace says it's not what you do. Now look over at Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, verse number 4. I'll start in verse 3. For what saith the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Now to him that works is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. So, if it's of works, it's no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. If it's of grace, it's no more of works. Now, to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Now, that's the end of the matter. That's the issue. There's two things there. Faith is not a work. See how he says that? But to him that worketh not, but believeth. Now you can work, you can ball that up, roll it up, smoke it, over, do whatever you want to with it. You can't change what it says. Faith is not a work. Faith is the only thing you can do without doing a work. There's no merit in faith. The merit is in what faith believes, what it trusts. To him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for right. Your faith in Jesus Christ and the work he did for you at Calvary is counted by God himself as though you paid the debt personally, because Jesus Christ died for you. Now, justification, that's the... You see the word justice in part of that word? That is a judicial courtroom action from the courtroom of heaven. And it's literally the judicial act of God's justice in response to your faith. Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Counting it unto him, imputing righteousness, that's justification unto eternal life. That's the payment for the penalty of your sin and my sin. God made him to be sin for us, so we made the righteousness of God in him. When Jesus Christ took our place at Calvary, when you trust him, then God takes your sin, counts it to his Son, his righteousness, and imputes it to you. And that's justification. Look with me at chapter 8. And here's something that you need to be careful to remember. Romans 8:33. People say, well, how do you get justified? Romans 8:33. Who shall anything to charge the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. God's the one who decides who's right with him. And he's the one that justifies us. He does it on the basis of the blood of Christ. He does it on the basis of being a free gift when we trust him. But he's the one that makes that choice. And for you to lose your salvation, for you to be saved, be justified, and then become unjustified, simply makes grace and justification a joke. It means they're meaningless. They don't have any value. Romans 8, verse 31, what shall we say then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, here's how he's for you, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth. If God said you're right with him, who's going to say anything different? Well, why'd God say that? Because he spared not his own son, but freely delivered him up for us all. Chapter 3, Paul's already said, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. God set his son forth to be the satisfying sacrifice for your sin debt, to pay for your sin, to take your guilt, my guilt, so that that guilt and that sin, that offense, could be cleared. And justification, it's not just clearing it, it's declaring you not just not guilty, but to be righteous. You see, Christ didn't just restore innocence, not guilty. He imputed righteousness. People sometimes say, well, did Christ restore what Adam lost? He did far more than that. He restored the clearing of sin, the innocence. He did that by forgiveness. That's the negative. But then he imputed his righteousness. And you and I share the righteousness of God the Son. And when God the Father looks at us, he sees us as accepted and as right as his own Son. We are accepted in the Beloved. And that's why Romans chapter 5 says, therefore, after describing all of that, in chapter 3 and 4, being, and I keep saying, that word being, the word to be is the word that describes an action or state of being. This is who you be. This is your identity. This is the real, actual, current, present identity in God's eyes that you and I have, being justified, being declared by God's justice to be accepted, being justified, being having his righteousness by faith, we have peace with God. There's no more. God's never against us. He's for us. That is, when you understand that is designed to produce in your heart, in your understanding, assurance. Because your assurance rests in who God's made you in his Son. And when he puts you into Christ, chapter 6, he baptizes us into Jesus Christ. He's made us a part of a complete, total victory program over sin. And also over Satan. He's delivered us from the power of darkness. When you begin to understand all that God did for you through the crosswork of Christ, you say, wow, even I can't screw that up. And you're pretty good at screwing things up. But God's made a provision for you in His Son. And the veracity of His own character and the essence of who He is for us. He says in Philemon, Philippians, He says, He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ. And that takes you over to Ephesians chapter number 1, where there's another line of reasoning. Ephesians 1:13. Anytime I have the opportunity to introduce someone to Christ, share the gospel with them, see them, and see someone make the choice to trust Christ, I do two things afterwards, at least. One is I ask them a question. Your view, do you understand? You won't be sure people understand. Brother Oscar Woodall used to talk about you don't want to have a stillbirth. You want somebody to really get saved. And that's because they understand the gospel. But if they understand the gospel, they'll be able to think from that paradigm. And you say to them, what will happen now the next time you sin? And if someone has really understood that Christ died for their sins, paid for their sin, and that's what dealt with it, invariably they'll say, well, Christ died for my sins. Because that's all they know, is that He died for their sins. And when you see that, you say, they got it. Because you didn't tell them that to start with. You told them how to get saved, that He died for their sins, that He paid for their sins, but you didn't tell them about the Christian life. But instinctively knowing that Christ paid it all, they understand that He forgave them all their sins. And they're able to think through from that gospel perspective. So when someone genuinely understands and genuinely gets saved, they're able to actually think, because that's all they know about dealing with sin. I love that verse in Acts 13 when Paul says that you're justified from all things which couldn't be justified from the law of Moses. You know what He justified? Everything. He forgave you all your trespasses. Well, if you think like the gospel teaches you, and you know what? You need to preach the gospel to yourself every now and then, maybe 6 or 8 times a day. Because when you sin, you need to remember that it didn't change for you. God doesn't treat His children worse than He treats lost people. People have the idea that, well, now that I'm saved, every time I sin, I better go ask God and, you know, humble myself and ask God to forgive me my sins. Or, you know, if I don't confess, 1 John 1:9, got to keep short accounts. And that's like after you get saved, now God's, he takes a lost guy and says, just come as you are, bring them all, and I'll forgive them all. Then you think, now I'm a child of God, and I got to do all these things to get. That's all backwards. The other thing that I try to do is show them this passage. Ephesians 1, verse 13, in whom you also trusted, that's in Christ, the last couple words of verse 12. After that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, notice the order. You hear the gospel. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. At verse in Romans, he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But the next verse says, how shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? And 2 verses before that, it says, with the heart, man believes unto righteousness. So when you believe, you get justified. Now, having believed, what would someone do? The natural thing would be to talk to the Lord about it. But you don't get saved by, people think you get saved by praying. You don't get saved by praying. You get saved by believing. And once you've believed, then it's natural to talk to the Lord because He's there. in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel. Nobody gets saved until they hear the gospel. People don't get saved by watching you. People don't get saved by getting convicted. They get saved by hearing the gospel and believing it. In whom also after you believe, watch what happened, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession. When you trusted Christ, God did something. You were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So actually, five specific things the Holy Spirit does at the moment that you trust Christ. But you're sealed. You're put in an encapsulized. You see, it says you're sealed with the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. Not by Him, but with Him. He is the seal. He becomes the permanent resident member of the Godhead that puts you in an encapsulized environment and you live in Him. And how long does it last? It's the earnest of our inheritance. It's the you're in the family. You're an heir. This is the down payment on your inheritance. And it's until the day of redemption. Until the redemption of the purchased possession. Look at chapter 4, verse 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. Your life is hid in God with Christ. And you're sealed there. And even when you try to wiggle out, and be honest with yourself, there are days when you just soon get out. I know it's not pious to say that. But there are days when you struggle and you think, you know, it'd just be easier. I talked to a brother just this past week, and they're talking about being home with the COVID and home with illness. And both of them said the same thing to me. Said, we're just sitting here waiting to die. And if you get there, you know, and you seem, dying is the only thing I see in my future. Be good to be saved when you're in that kind of situation, because then you've got a real future. But when you struggle and you think, you know, things are going sideways, and you have to do that fight of faith, that good fight of faith, to really, I'm going to believe these things, and I'm going to make it true. To know that you're sealed and you can't get out, even when maybe you think it'd be easier to get out, go back to the old life. Never is, but you think that sometime. That's that verse in 2 Timothy 2:13. Even if we believe not, He abides faithful. He made you a part of His body. You see there in chapter 5, verse 30, He says, for we are members of His body, of His flesh and of His bones. And can I tell you that all the mutilating, all the cutting, all the deformation of the body of Jesus Christ has been done, is over with. Nobody will ever touch His body again. And to take you out of His body means you'd have to cut you out of Him. That ain't going to happen. Nobody's going to lay a hand on Him. And you've been sealed there until the day of redemption. Now, what's going to happen at the day of redemption? You're going to get your new glorified body. And all that old man that you have, that old life, that old thinking that makes you, you know, makes you want to do all that, be gone. And you just have that glorified body. And all that struggle. And one of the reasons I would tell you that people have a hard time understanding the security is because they don't have a proper understanding of the fact that you do possess an old man, an old life, not an old man. But you do have that put off the old man, put on the new man. That struggle of that body of sin that continues with you. Old timers call it the old sin nature. And if you don't understand how to walk in the Spirit and not walk in the flesh, then you think, how could this struggle be in me? But that's Galatians 5 said, that's a picture, a guarantee that you are saved. Because lost people don't have that struggle. But that sealing is security. So when you understand the greatness of what God's done, Those doctrines are designed to give you assurance, and when you don't have those, and you aren't being instructed in them, and you don't know how to find them in the Scripture and rejoice in them, well, then you don't have the edification basis upon which to understand what salvation really is all about. So no, you're not going to lose your salvation. Don't let verses that don't have anything to do with you scare you into thinking you do, confuse you into thinking you do. Come to understand what God's really done for the greatness of it. And get that full assurance that those doctrines of grace are designed to give you so that you can have that calm, assurance, and boldness. I think in Romans 5, he says, knowing this stuff, we glory in tribulation also. Knowing that tribulation works patience, we understand that trouble in the life of a believer is not an indication of God's unhappiness with us. We know that his justice deals with us differently. Now, we read this morning about God's unhappiness with Israel under the law because of their performance. But we know that isn't how he deals with us. It deals with us under grace. So just having that understanding can give you some assurance. So no, you're eternally secure in Christ because it's what he did, not what you do. And you're part of God's eternal purpose in his body. Okay? So go home happy. A lady told me this morning, last Sunday, she was telling me about how depressed she was. She'd been sick with the COVID, been sick with this and the next thing. And she said, I'm just depressed, and I've been depressed, and I can't get out of it. And I said, well, you know, there's a set of teaching in there called Depression Matters. Why don't you get that and take it home and listen to it? She told me this morning, she said, I put that first study in, and 20 minutes into it, I was over it. She said, it was that easy. And I said, well, what was the key? She said, you know what the key was. You gave me the formula. I said, I know. I'm just let you tell me that you know. She said, Thanksgiving. When you sit and focus on self-pity, you're going to be depressed. If I sat around and think about you or me all day long, I'd be depressed too. But when you put the joy of the Lord in, when you rejoice in hope of glory of God, when you look at who he's made you, what you're a part of in him, then you can't help but be happy. And when you swap self-pity for thanksgiving, depression goes away and joy, sunlight, comes. So don't get caught up in the negative of who you are. Get caught up in the sunlight of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Okay? Praise the Lord. Glory. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. We thank you for our Savior. And that these things work really in our lives to produce stability and joy so that the God of hope can fill us with joy and peace in believing by the power of the Spirit of God. We thank you in his name. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord.